Blackstone Audio presents The Blue Door by David Fulmer. For the true members of the Jombroni and Pritzi families, larger heroes than I could ever create, and in particular to my mother, Flora Pritzi Fulmer, my father, Thurston Fulmer, who long ago earned an honorary vowel on the end of his name, and my sister, Karen Mertz, who is the bravest of us all. It is my honor to be the blood of their blood. I want to hit him, step away, and watch him hurt. I want his heart. Joe Frazier. Chapter 1. At 10:30 on the night of March 24, 1962, Eddie Cero walked out the back door of the Southside Boxing Club in Philadelphia with a bloody bandage over his eyebrow and $40 cash in his pocket. The cut hadn't hurt when it opened. Now it was throbbing, and all he wanted was to go somewhere and have a drink to kill the pain and another one to toast what looked like the end of his life as a welterweight. He didn't want to see anybody, and he didn't want anyone seeing him, so he cut down the alley behind the club, zipping his jacket against the night's chill. 50 feet away from the East Allen traffic, he heard someone grunt and another voice curse, and he glanced into a doorway to see two punks roughing up a third man, who looked to be getting the better of it. He walked by with no intention of meddling in their business. Then one of the punks turned around and said, "What the fuck are you looking at?" in the wrong tone. Eddie stopped. A face as thin and pitted as a crescent moon glared from the shadows. "I said, motherfucker, what the fuck are you looking at?" The partner, a chubby greaseball in a motorcycle jacket that was two sizes too small, turned like a fat lizard to put his 2 cents in. "Take a hike, asshole." The poor chump in the middle let out a strangled gasp. Eddie stayed where he was. "What are you, fucking deaf?" The moon-faced punk came stalking out in a rude ballet set to the click and flash of a blade. He had taken 3 steps when it dawned on him that the interloper hadn't cut and run. By then it was too late, because Eddie had one coming, a quick right to the jaw. The punk went down as if a trap door had opened under his shoes. The switchblade skittered across the bricks.
"Whoa, fucking A," said the fat boy.
Staring up at the night sky with glazed eyes, the pimpled punk moaned and twitched a couple times. Eddie rubbed his knuckles.
"You better get him out of here."
The fat boy let go of their prey and edged into the alley. He bent down, wrestled his partner under the arms, and dragged him off in the direction of 9th Street. Once he got a little distance, he looked back over his shoulder and said,
"We'll see you around, Sal."
The guy named Sal slumped against the doorframe.
Yeah, same to you."
His voice was a weary croak. Eddie walked over to have a look at the victim, a middle-aged guy, Italian. His lower lip was swollen, his left eye was puffing up all purple, and there was fresh blood dribbling out of one nostril. He looked like an empty sack of nothing, as if the beating in an alley was just the last insult in what had been a bad day all around. He weaved on his feet, trying to straighten his tie with one hand and brush the dirt from his sport coat with the other.
"Jesus Christ," he said. "That was a hell of a smack you gave him."
He peered at Eddie with his good eye, then pointed a stubby finger.
"Hey, I know you. You're a fighter, right?"
"Yeah, that's right," Eddie said shortly. "You going to be okay?" He started moving away.
"Hey, wait a minute."
Sal ambled woozily after him.
"Hey, let me buy you a drink. How about it?"
"That's all right.
Come on, you saved my ass here."
Eddie said,
"It was nothing. You were doing okay." "I want to buy you a drink, goddammit."
Eddie sighed. He didn't feel up to arguing.
"All right, one drink. But you don't owe me, okay?" Yeah, okay," Sal said. "I don't owe you, God forbid. So, what's that name again, tough guy?"
"Eddie Cero."
"That's right. I remember, like Zero with a C, right?"
"Yeah, that's right."
"Salvatore Jombroni."
He offered a thick meatball of a hand.
"Sal."
On a good night, Eddie would have gone to Barney's on Frankfurt Avenue, but he didn't want to meet up with that crowd, so he headed 2 blocks up to the corner bar and grill in Richmond, where hardly anyone knew him. Plus, they had a better jukebox. Sal shuffled along, one hand dabbing his bloody nose with a handkerchief, while he probed his battered eye with the fingers of the other and muttered under his breath. Eddie held the door for him, and they stepped into a long, narrow room of black and gray shadows, punctuated by rainbow-colored beer signs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.